First of all, Mr. Governor, why do you believe restarting this will work now? It's been tried before and the economy's a long way from a healthy state.
But it would have been even worse had we not taken the action that we did in 2009. So today we decided to create £75 billion of new money and inject it into the economy. And that will be spent by the people who sell government bonds to us. They'll be buying either things, or they'll be buying financial assets. They'll be buying securities issued by companies that want to finance themselves. The money will seep around different parts of the economy and will tend to stimulate demand in the economy as a whole. So this has been done to support the level of the British economy.
How do you guarantee, though, that the money seeps to the right places? How do you make sure it doesn't just stay on bank balance sheets, for example?
Well, it will certainly affect the yields on various assets that people want to issue to finance their businesses. It will affect the wealth of pension funds and indeed individuals who own financial assets. And that would, we would expect, would affect their spending. That's what happened when we did it before. And our study shows that it did work before. Of course, the world economy can change quickly. So what we need to do 1 year, 1 month, may need to be changed.
But you've taken this decision now, you say, because the slackening off in the economy is much worse than you had feared.
Yes.
How then can you be so certain that another round of metaphorically printing money will make that difference when the circumstances are deteriorating so quickly?
Well, I can't guarantee that the world economy won't change in a way that will make our position very difficult. But what I do know is that taking this measure will make it better than it would have been otherwise. So this is the right thing to do, and it will improve the position of the UK economy.
What differences can you expect our viewers to notice having taken this decision?
Well, I think you will find that the concern that people are really worried about now, that the UK economy will slow very sharply, I hope will not materialise, and the economy will indeed continue to recover. After all, it is still growing. We shouldn't forget that fact. So we've taken this preemptively to prevent what would otherwise be a slowdown.
A double dip? Do you think this will prevent a double dip? Is that your hope?
Well, I don't know what would have happened had we not taken this measure, because that's in the future and we will see. But there is no doubt that conditions in the world economy have changed. The American economy is slowing sharply. The Chinese economy is slowing. And of course, the European economy, both the periphery countries and indeed the core of Europe, has also slowed very sharply. So there is a major world economic crisis. Let's not beat around the bush. This is a major crisis. And we are taking steps to make that less severe.
But can that step on its own really prevent things sliding further? I know the Bank of England's evidence shows that quantitative easing previously did have an effect.
Yes.
But on its own, returning to a tool that's been tried before, can that really make that much difference?
It certainly makes a difference, and it's the right thing to do. Of course, we can't determine what happens in the world economy. That will depend upon what other countries do. All we can do is to take the right steps for the UK economy, and that's what we've done today.
To what extent, though, are we a hostage to what's happening in the rest of the world economy, particularly in the Eurozone, with all the anxieties around what's happening with banks across Europe?
Well, in your phrase, we are always a hostage to the world economy. We always have been. We are part of an integrated world trading economy, and what happens abroad has an enormous impact on us. There's nothing we can do about that. And indeed, we benefit enormously from trading with other countries. Our prosperity is based on trade. There are times when the rest of the world economy goes into a deep recession where we will suffer as a consequence. Now, I hope that together with other countries taking similar steps, it will be possible to rebalance the world economy to prevent that outcome from taking place.
Is this then the beginning of a coordinated move with other countries? Are you discussing similar action and perhaps other ideas with other countries right now?
I've been discussing these with other countries for many years now. The problem is more difficult today. It was an easier problem in 2008 to 2009, because then every country simply needed to cut interest rates and have fiscal easing. That was the easy part, and to recapitalise banks. The difficult part now is that what each country needs to do depends on its own circumstances. In addition to countries like ourselves, like the United States, like some countries in Europe, we need to rebalance our economy. We need to slow the amount of domestic spending and to boost our trade position, to see our exports be the source of growth, so that we're relying less on borrowing from abroad than we have been. But that requires other countries, countries like China, countries like Japan, countries like Germany, to expand their domestic spending so that they will lend less to us and we can reduce our borrowing within the framework of a healthy world economy.
There is a risk returning to quantitative easing that inflation starts to run away with us. Now, our viewers are already feeling it. Every time they go to the till, every time they go to fill up the car, everybody is feeling the squeeze on prices already very dramatically. Now, how can you be confident that unleashing another round of this won't lead to even greater inflation for people to contend with?
Well, there are two reasons why I'm confident it won't. The first is that the main source of rising prices this year has come from outside our own economy. It's come from rising oil and petrol prices, from higher gas and electricity prices, reflecting higher energy prices at world level, higher food prices, and of course higher VAT at the beginning of the year. That has pretty well come to an end. There are a few more gas and electricity price increases this month. The number for inflation that we'll see published in 2 weeks' time is likely to be over 5%. But that, we think, is the peak.
How can you be confident?
Well, because the impact of those factors is not going to recur. You can never be certain, but the government is not planning to raise VAT again. We've seen in the last month quite sharp falls in oil prices, and other commodity prices have been falling back. So this is beginning to go into reverse, and with a slowdown in the world economy, that's not surprising. So we would expect that inflation will fall sharply in the first few months of next year.
So turning to another round of QE in the short term is worth the potential risks of inflation, even though that's, you know, safeguarding the inflation target is one of your primary jobs.
It is our primary target and we're sticking to it. It takes time for our actions to work through the economy. So what we do today and in the next few months will affect the economy and inflation 9 months, 18 months from now. And we are more concerned at present that actually inflation could fall below our target looking further ahead. That's why we've taken this action to inject more money into the economy today.
Taking this action is, in a sense, plan B, isn't it?
Well, I don't like to think of plan A, plan B. Monetary policy is the right policy to take the strain when there are changes in the economic environment. It's only a few months ago since people were saying, well, perhaps interest rates should go up to deal with the rising inflation problem. I think most people have come to the view now that actually the world has changed since then. Whatever the arguments for and against 3 or 4 months ago, the world is different now than it was then. And we can change our policy very quickly. You can't expect other policies to change. A government can't change its spending programs, it can't change its plans for the health service every 2 or 3 months. We can change monetary policy every month. So we are the right vehicle to respond to these fluctuations in the world economy.
But to the extent to which the current Chancellor previously said that quantitative easing was a sign of last resort, it was a desperate measure. I mean, this isn't where his plan A was meant to take us, is it?
I don't think that's what I understand to be. His plan A is about a plan for a credible medium-term path for the public finances, which is needed not just for our economy, but for all economies. The point about monetary policy is that it can be changed every month in either direction according to changes in circumstances. And that's what our job is. We can change quickly and rapidly in response to changes in circumstances. That's what we've done today.
And how long do you expect this action to last? You say you can change quickly, you can respond very much to things as they proceed. How long do you think this will have to go on?
Well, that's impossible to tell because I don't pretend that we have a crystal ball for the world economy. What I do know is that as we see changes in the world economy, then we can respond.
In terms of people watching the Bank of England do what would in normal times be considered to be an extraordinary measure for a country like the UK essentially to be printing money, what's your message to ordinary people who are desperately worried about their jobs, paying their bills, making ends meet? Should they be alarmed by the fact that you're having to take this measure?
No,
what should ordinary people think?
They shouldn't be alarmed, and I want to explain why. For most of our lifetimes, monetary policy has been about trying to limit the rate at which money grows in the economy. There has often been too much money in the economy, pushing up inflation. And that's the world in which we, and indeed for that matter our parents, lived. The situation today, since the financial crisis that began in 2007, 2008, is completely different. There is not enough money in the economy today. That is why we've taken this measure to create money in order to ensure that there is sufficient money to support the recovery, to support jobs, while ensuring that inflation remains close to our target. And that's what we're doing.
And finally, can our viewers expect to return to the kind of living standards that they had 3 or 4 years ago anytime soon?
Well, not immediately. We've seen a big squeeze on our living standards, but what is the case is that that squeeze is unlikely to continue. I think we're past the worst, and from now on we should be in a position where slowly but gradually living standards, real take-home pay, will be able to pick up. That's the world we want to get back to. We shouldn't expect rapid increases. You can't get something for nothing. But I believe that soon we should be able to return to a point when slow but steady increases in real take-home pay will start to come through. We are a long way from being back to normal, and it will take many years to get back to normal after this extraordinary world financial crisis. I am desperately keen that we can get back to a world soon in which interest rates are at normal levels and in which savers have a return for their savings. But we can't do that immediately, because to do so would be to plunge the UK economy back into recession. This will need a coordinated effort around the world to get back to a point where economies are balanced and we can return to normal interest rates, steady growth, with essentially, from our point of view, low inflation.
Mr. Governor, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.